Hi, everybody. We're so glad you joined us today for this SuperHero Mission Lab webinar. Upside down mentoring. Have you ever heard of that before? Well, you're going to learn all about it today, and we're going to connect in innovative and creative ways. I want to do a little housekeeping first. Some of you have called in, which is great if the computer isn't working on your end or you're just having incompatibility issues, so that should work really well. We will send everybody the presentation afterwards in a PDF form, so you don't have to take notes unless you want to. Also, if the software on our end is a little slow, just be patient. It will actually come to a point where it will fix itself, but there's a little bit of slowness. And that said, also text us on the left-hand side of your screen. You'll see a chat room. You can text us and we'll see it and answer your question, or you can tell us if you're having any issues. So without further ado, we're going to get started. Happy Friday, too, by the way. So when we talk about superhero mission labs, whether you've heard that term or not, it's really the origin of it was built around fourth graders, believe it or not, because research has shown that fourth graders is the perfect age. That kids are still not worried about their peers. There's no fear of failure. They're at their most creative. And what we're trying to do today is reconnect all of us to that childlike ability to think creatively. So you'll notice I had a little bit of issue with the slide there, so got ahead of me. So what we're going to do today is talk about creative skill building and how we can all become better innovative thinkers. We're going to talk about looking at a problem with fresh eyes, reestablishing patterns that cut through the clutter that help you focus. That's really key. Recognizing that simple thinking is the path to purest innovation. And how we forget our personal agendas. How much time do we spend on inner office politics? So we're going to try to really break through that today and how we get around that. And again, just focusing on the solution is really key in being creative and innovative. So I'm going to introduce our speakers today. Leanne Piera, who Leanne and I worked together for many years when I was with Wyndham, and she ran the events team for the Susan G. Komen Breast Cancer Foundation. So she has been on the nonprofit side and the profit side. As you'll see, she ran events for KPMG, Big Four accounting firm, also for many years. And I'm going to let her talk a little bit about what she does for the Boy Scouts, but also she has a firm called Juniper Originals, and we freelance a lot together and work together on projects. And she's come in as a superhero mission lab leader. So, Leanne, welcome.
Well, thanks, Carrie. Yeah. Because my background is events and getting people together, one of the things that I've seen over my long career is that the more you can bring people together face to face, and the more diverse and unique the grouping is, the better it works together. So when we're talking about adding youth and young children to the mix, I get really excited about it because it's a new dynamic that the world has yet to explore. So we'll hear more about
I
that
love it.
from our next speaker.
And you've raised Eagle Scouts too, which I think is interesting too.
I have, yes.
I want to come back to that.
All right.
All right. And then would you like to introduce Logan, our creative director?
Yes, Logan Broussard is the creative director for Broussard Global, and his history is an amazing career in creative art and advertising. One of the things that amazes me about Logan is his power of observation. when I come into a room, it's just like, boom, get business going, go to it. But Logan always takes a look around and he sees what's really in the room. He doesn't focus in on just that one thing that's calling his attention. He takes a moment to observe what's going on and what's around him, his surroundings. So that natural curiosity is a good part about Logan's spirit. You want to say something about
that, Logan? Thanks a lot. It's good to be here. The other thing is that talent can also be a curse. But I mean, but the fact that I get, you know, off on tangents sometimes. But I mean, it's, hey, you live with what you got, right? That's the deal. So really what we're talking about with the children's aspect, this is, we're going to be seeing a YouTube video soon on this 10-year-old who she's Adora Stiptak. I can't pronounce her name real well, but the thing is she is adorable. So it's going to be a great little YouTube video that we're going to be seeing based on what she's saying, how kids can be the creative side of it. So,
perfect. I think that's great, Logan, that you set this up, and I will set this up for the crew that's part of this webinar today. There'll be a little bit of a delay when this video starts. It's going to be probably 2 minutes of hearing what Adora Stiptak has to say during her TED Talk. So listen up. And then once I stop it, I'll go back to the slides.
So I got to remember that.
Now, I wanted to start with a question. When was the last time you were called childish? For kids like me, being called childish can be a frequent occurrence. Every time we make irrational demands, exhibit irresponsible behavior, or display any other signs of being normal American citizens, we are called childish. Which really bothers me. After all, take a look at these events. Imperialism and colonization, world wars, George W. Bush, ask yourself, who's responsible? Adults. Now, what have kids done? Well, Anne Frank touched millions with her powerful account of the Holocaust. Ruby Bridges helped to end segregation in the United States. And most recently, Charlie Simpson helped to raise 120,000 pounds for Haiti on his little bike. So as you can see evidenced by such examples, age has absolutely nothing to do with it. The traits the word childish addresses are seen so often in adults that we should abolish this age discriminatory word when it comes to criticizing behavior associated with irresponsibility and irrational thinking.
Well, she does not the best. We really enjoy her and her concepts, and it brings to life the idea of looking at children and working with children and letting them teach us as adults. But one of the questions I have for Logan is, why is it that kids are more collaborative and more creative? And then the next question would be, can we as adults regain our creativity?
Well, to answer the first part of the question is, kids are much more curious because their life hasn't really been that long yet. So therefore, they still have a lot of curiosity based around what's going on in the world. That also helps in their observation, which we will talk about later on a little bit too. And it's an interesting point of Picasso, you know, the famous, everyone knows Picasso. And they'd all love to own one, right? But his point was saying, he was saying, I have spent the last 40 to 45 years of my life trying to go back in time and set up my childlike curiosity that I had when I was 6 years old. So that's really makes the point of that's where the juice of the thing is back to the innovation of that curious child.
So somebody just chatted to us that they didn't hear the audio on the video. If you did not, we're kind of rehashing it in a way, but we'll send you the link to the video after this as well. But anyway, going on that, the creative takeaways from the video, if you didn't hear, she reiterates that kids look at things with fresh eyes and they are able to cut through the clutter and come up with innovative ideas. And sometimes adults don't. As a matter of fact, sometimes adults come up with things that aren't really innovative and they hurt the world. So she talks a little bit about that. And then also just that, isn't it about time to stop thinking that kids are childish and don't have good ideas? We should really respect that thinking and acting and being a little bit childish, even in the workplace, can be a positive.
So I know that we're going to walk through several things today, and I just want to outline them a little bit for us. We're going to take a look at sharpening your curiosity, making yourself more observant. How do you do that? Leaving fear of failure behind you. So what if Susie or Johnny thinks that you failed? So what if you do? Go out and do something different. Go make it bigger and better. Breaking the framework. Logan's going to tell us about what that means and how to do it. And then leaving competition with your peers out of your agenda. This is something we as adults do all the time. Just let it go. Taking joy and have a nonsense eureka moment. Aha, we did it. Yay, team. Understanding that creating by committee, well, we all know this, creating by committee has never solved the problem. Never. So, Logan, would you like to start us on how we begin to sharpen our creativity?
Sure. The curiosity and creativity. But sharpening your curiosity, like I said, goes back to the point when you were your lifetime. You haven't been around that much. You don't have that much experience. So therefore, you are curious about everything from an ant crawling on a leaf to something where you actually find yourself going into another thing, into another space and time. You've lost yourself. So it's one of those things where it also helps you the curiosity helps you develop your observation. Mm-hmm. And that's where that muscle is a good development.
Yes.
So you will heighten those curiosity skills by developing it. We've actually usually starting off in the beginning of an exercise or you have the homework done at the end. But Leanne's going to take you through a homework assignment. I think that we've developed that really helps you work with your observation skills.
So this is actually a neat exercise, and I really do hope that everyone does this because it does make a difference and it does teach you how to do it. What we're going to do is for 10 days in a row, we're going to take one picture a day, just one a day, of a different thing or a different object in that space between leaving your front door and going out to your car or your bus stop or whatever it is. So in that little space of time, every single day for the next 10 days, take a picture. 10 different pictures, 10 different days. And then you're going to be surprised what you notice. The things that you've never seen, things that you don't notice because you're just so focused on getting to your car. Now, one of the things that I've seen as I've gone through this exercise is that even though I'm observing new and different things, I'm still taking the photographs like a rigid adult. They're all framed. The lighting has to be this way or that way. A child might just swing the camera and click and get something totally different. So I'm trying to make myself think a little bit even further along. Not only do I observe, but how would I capture it in a different way?
You know, who comes to mind is Bill Eggleston, William Eggleston, the famous photographer. And that's a lot of what when you read about how he's so good and so successful, and that's exactly how he approaches photography. It's interesting.
The other thing, too, is that by the end of those 10 days, you're going to be quite surprised at what pictures you've got in your little file. Because the thing is, those are going to be items or objects that you see every day, that you've been seeing every day for years. And all of a sudden, you're beginning to see a quality about
and a new beauty in them. Yeah. So that's one way of us breaking in our curiosity and refreshing it. Logan, what step two? No fear of failing. How do we do this? What is the lesson we learn from kids?
Well, again, back to the point of children really don't have set up an agenda, a hidden agenda for themselves or their peers. They really go into a project. They're focused. They don't worry about the fact that maybe it doesn't work out after they've processed it or have their unsuccess. What they actually do is turn that negative, which most people think, or most bosses sometimes want you to say, okay, if you fail at this, then you wasted the time. Well, there is no waste of time in a child's mind, because what he does is he finds the positive aspect of what not to do, or he learns the lesson of unsuccesses by his failures. So that's the reason why a child actually keeps moving and keeps focused on solving the problem as opposed to giving up on a project.
Yeah, you know what? And I'm going to take you through another exercise here. It's a little game. It's a little guessing game of adults, the very few adults who are able to go through and not have that fear of failing. And we've all heard of these people because now they're famous for their successes, but we don't see that in the past they too failed. So this first one for us, for example, who is this? This news anchor was fired from her position because she was told she was not cut out for television. I already see one right answer. Carrie, you want to bring it up? Who is that?
Some smart person out there says
Oprah Winfrey. Way go team. Okay, so this person here, the next one.
Bingo, you got it.
Yeah.
You win the toaster.
No, you get a toaster. All righty. So this person was fired from his journalism job because he was told he was not creative.
Who can that be? This is a tough one. Anybody out there got it?
All right, let's go on. Who is, and you may not recognize from this old photo, but that's Walt Disney. Not creative. Can you believe that? Honestly. And in fact, I think Logan has an anecdote about Walt Disney that really is pretty interesting.
Well, there's a little sidebar about that, is that they did research way in the beginning before they started animation series. And they were saying, what is the best animal to animate? What is the most endearing kind of creature we can animate? And through all their research they did, the mouse came up the very last thing. They said, women are afraid of mice. They just are not that endearing. They're not that cute. So the whole research and the numbers and everything came back that, hey, do not touch a mouse. Don't even think about animating a mouse. And of course, Walt Disney, with his great passion, said, I disagree with these numbers completely, and we're going to go ahead with the mouse character. So
Mickey Mouse was born.
And right. Mickey Mouse was
born. And then Minnie Mouse was born.
So right. And, you know, he went with the magic of the emotion. He didn't take that common sense path that we as adults are ingrained. Oh, the numbers say this. It must be true. There's Walt Disney for us. Okay, so this guy, and I find this one so hard to believe. He was cut from his high school basketball team for his slowness. And you know who this is? Yep. Michael Jordan. Can you believe it? And now he's been
Jill got it. Congratulations, Jill.
He was a 6-time NBA champion. He's changed the world of basketball. And if he had believed that coach way back when, he'd be selling used cars for a living. Who knows?
Amazing.
It is amazing. Okay, so this person, and this one's cool too. Rejected from film and television schools 4 times. Now, you already know that he's not going to take no for an answer because he tried to get into school 4 times. What did this man do at the end of the day?
Anybody know?
Yep, it's Steven Spielberg. Look at that. Jaws, E.T., Jurassic Park. This man is just the highest grossing director in history with his Jurassic Park. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. But he was rejected. Oh, no, he couldn't apply for film school.
So
that was kind of a neat little game just to show us all that just because you look at people that have been successful, it doesn't mean they just jumped to that success. They had to take that fear out of their equation and just keep on going.
And we also think that, too, that they learn from those defeats and those failures. They've figured out that, you know, maybe I do have to work on certain aspects of my character that will put me onto the next level. So who knows? I mean, we can't read their minds, but We hope that's...
Well, I think it also, it's incentive and inspiration for all of us. Never give up. And also, if there's somebody on your team who fails, you know, it's not necessarily the next step to fire that person or to, you know, not at least help them learn through their mistakes. So I think it's a great lesson to have these people who are so successful.
I agree.
So Leanne and Logan, I'm going to set you all up for talking about breaking the frame, which is one of the next steps in innovation. And we have been working with Bill Nye, the Science Guy, and he had a one of his Star Talk podcast in Austin at the end of last year during Fun Fest, if any of y'all have ever been to that. And he interviewed Dr. Roberta Ness, who actually is Vice President of Innovation at University of Texas at Houston. And we have gotten to explore a lot of her research as well. Over the last 18 months, much research has been done around this subject matter, especially because our desire as a society and even a world, our desire for innovation has never been greater. But what we're finding is that we have a low supply of really creativity and innovation. And so companies are suffering. As a matter of fact, again, the research is showing that the primary characteristic that CEOs are looking for in the workforce is innovation. And so as we talk about breaking the frame, and again, Logan's going to go into this, this is really key for us as individuals and leaders in our companies and organizations to hone these skills, these creativity skills, and these innovation skills.
And so I'm going to kind of click. I'm going to go into my CSI voice. And it's like, I hope I can pull this off. But yes, they walked into the room. They found Gary and Nancy dead on the floor in a pool of water and shards of glass around their bodies. What is the mystery of why they died?
Ooh, I'm scared.
Yeah, me too.
So I hope that CSI worked. So as you all understand, you got it, right? The mystery is this couple is dead on the floor. What happened? Well, the frame breaker, you ready for the answer? The frame breaker is that Gary and Nancy are goldfish, and their bowl was kicked off the table. It broke. They were found dead in a pool of water and shards of glass.
Boom!
That is a point when you're expecting it, because Gary and Nancy, you would think, are human because of the names. All you've done is we've taken you to that point, and so you've realized, okay, they're human, so what could have happened? What's the mystery? Well, we left out that part about the goldfish, because that's the surprise. That's the frame breaker aspect of it. And that's to be creative, to get that imagination going and that innovation happening. That's the way to do it, is break the frame. That's one example.
I'm trying to say, this is the normal, this is the standard. What is different? What's the opposite? What's the next step? What's the, you know, what if I started from the beginning? Those kinds of things, to think it through a different way instead of accepting that the norm is the only way it should be.
Is that kind of... Especially our expectations, I think, mm-hmm. are, that's breaking our expectations of expecting something.
Right.
Right.
Well, I know you've seen advertising campaigns like,
yeah, Volkswagen. I mean, they were one of the first pioneers in breaking the frame, because in their marketing communications, of course, their automobile was what they did, what everybody else did. They showed a picture of their car, their automobile, but rather than talk about the seats or how well the tires, the drive, the ride, they actually took terms in the automobile industry that were negative. And so here they showed the car. It just happens to have a nice round shape like a lemon. So therefore they labeled it a negative thing for you to get into the copy and to read the copy. The same with the size of the car. The car had that aspect when everybody was driving around in big boats. Then they were saying, think small, which because the normal thing in those times, an advertising man would say, think big.
Did this appeal to the baby boomers when we were kind of millennial age, would you say?
Probably so. I mean, Volkswagen actually probably came, even the hipsters of that day went for the Volkswagen, whether it be the bus, the old
flower power.
Flower power.
That's right. I remember those days.
I think you drove one of those, didn't you? Okay.
So it's a good idea to break the frame. And then,
so if we review what we've gone over so far, then we've talked about sharpening your curiosity through our observing skills, our observance, leaving fear of failure behind you, talking about Michael Jordan and Oprah and how they left that behind and those great examples. And then the breaking of the framework, going beyond our expectations and really opening our opportunities to find things that break our frames. And then now you're going to talk about leaving competition with your peers out of your agenda. This is a tough one. How do you do that?
Well, it's certainly, it's really shown in Survivor Island how people do set up agendas, hidden agendas. They throw people under the bus on the islands. It's a whole setup thing where that comes with years of really paranoia. I mean, I don't need to be that negative, but the thing is, children just do not have that key in them yet. They don't worry about the trying to stab the other child in the back on a project. What they do is look. They're first to be collaborators. They're first to bring somebody else in. If they see a person that can draw, they'll grab them and say, hey, draw up this thing. We've got this idea. Or the person that knows how to cut wood, they'll put them on the clubhouse part of it. So it's very, very...
So one of the examples I like to think about is one of the competition is that the pie theory. There's only so many slices of pie, and you got your cherry pie and I've got my lemon meringue pie, and there's only so many slices. Well, the reality is that's not true. There is enough pie for everyone, regardless of your business or your talent. There's always room. The world is big. The world is huge. And you don't have to stay in that little tiny pond. And so to heck with the competition and what they're doing and how they're doing it, if you focus on your passion, leave them behind, you can grow without any restraints or trying to keep up with them.
So the pie becomes that much bigger, you're saying.
Yeah,
so,
it's an endless pie.
And the wasted time that goes into thinking about the politics of our jobs or the workplace has really takes up so much time that you don't have time to focus on your creative and your innovative thinking.
Right.
And it's really important for a leader to be able to bring that out in their team.
Right. And Charles, do not have any sense of a limitation or limitless. So it's quite a different thing for them.
I agree with that. And I think that limitless is the key word. Your creativity is limitless. Your capacity for growth is limitless, and your capacity for joy. This number five step, take joy. Kids will give themselves high fives. They'll break out in laughter. It's awesome to see this. And if one kid's laughing because they're just having a great time, or they're smiling because they just, colored the best picture that they've ever colored, it's the whole room. It's infectious. It goes around. It's just wonderful. So why is it that we have to stop as adults and say, hey, we did it. We're awesome. Yay, team. And just jump up and down. Logan?
Well, first of all, it loosens you up. But also physically, it makes you more childlike. And you begin to appreciate the simpleness of having a small success. Don't try to save all this joy for the for the big successes. Go for the little ones, too. And then the other thing, too, is that corporations – they kind of set you up as the environment, it opens a better environment. Because if you think about it, corporations are pretty physically set up in their habitat of the desks are here, everything is lockstep. When you step out of the box or color out of the box, then you're kind of punished for it in a certain way. And I think that what corporations should be doing is not, they want you to be innovative, but then they set you up as when you start using tenets of being innovative,
they look at you a little funny.
Yeah. Like you're wasting time.
Right.
But you know, there are companies now that have figured it out. The Googles, the Pixels, those are the ones that everybody hears about and wants to go work for because they're so cool and they have the open environment. Well, one of the things that kids can bring into that workforce is the breaking down of walls. No kid is ever going to stay in their little cubicle because that's where they've been assigned. They're going to be all over that office.
So this is a good thing for people with ADD.
Yeah. Like yeah, that. It really is. It really is. So
Logan and Leanne, talk about this slide. This is really intriguing to me.
Well, of course, there's a saying, it's been around, maybe a lot of you have heard this saying before, but a horse is a camel is a horse designed by a committee. So in other words, it's like when you have a big group of people, they all sit around, they all want to have their finger signature in the project. So therefore, one person says, well, it needs a hump. And then another person says, well, if a hump is good for the water system, then it needs two humps. So that's basically the whole concept of designing a camel.
So we need to take that committee philosophy that so many of us embrace because we think more minds around the table, the better. And then what should we do with it? We still need those minds. We still need that information right. And those ideas. But how do we capture it in a better way?
Well, the key to that is the breakout. And we're in twos and threes.
Oh, yeah.
They seem to think that that's a magic number on the teams. In the ad world, it's been a copywriter and art director. And that's a two team. And then what happens, then everybody comes back together with those ideas. And then a good leader has them present their ideas. And then they do discuss the different pieces, but it's not everybody trying to solve the problem at once and everybody trying to get their ideas jammed into the problem.
Yeah. So instead of a group of 25 people all trying to decide the same idea in the same way that one advertisement will work, you've got people that break apart and into groups, and you end up with 12 different types of ideas that you can then evaluate and take a look at and decide which are the best, and then go out in 12 more groups and decide how to develop those, rather than having everybody in the same committee. Because once, you know, somebody naysays it or decides mm-hmm. that blue is the only color it can be, it becomes more and more and more narrow, and zero creativity comes
right.
out of it.
Right. There was a study too, just quickly, but it came to mind that the company had children come in to their office space, and they were saying they had problems with trafficking, with too much movement. I mean, too slowness in the trafficking. And the simple idea the kids came up with was they came back and said, "You're having too many meetings." I mean, brilliant. It's a brilliant thing. So it's funny how children can cut through that clutter. They're natural collaborators, so they break through that clutter.
Yeah, I have an example of that as well, because when we've done this exercise that I'm going to talk about in other Mission Lab type meetings and environments, and what we did was pose a problem to adults. And while we were posing that problem, we had pictures that might, you know, spark an idea or whatever around the room or passing around and letting them do that. But the question that we posed to these adults to solve was, how do you get your child to clean their teeth twice a day? Everybody knows that this is a struggle. Kids or no kids, whether you have them or not, nobody wants, it's just as a parent. So please, adults, break up in your little pairs and come up with some really neat ideas. And I'll tell you what they did. They were really creative. They came up with ice cream toothpaste. They came up with chocolate toothpaste. They came up with a toothbrush that played music. And they just had some really, really great ideas.
And you gave them these thought starters that
Yeah, these were the pictures that they were shown just to maybe, you know, maybe spark an idea or not. They even came up with bribery, for goodness sakes. I don't know where that one came out, but, you know, it's always a good thing. And that was the adults. So, they came up with great ideas. But the one thing that a children group comes up with is that it doesn't even have to be a brush. Why did every adult was brushing or toothpaste, just modifying what already existed? The kids didn't. They started with food that you could eat and it would clean your teeth. A robot that would come in and do it at night. The tooth fairy. Kind of hard to put that one in place, but you know, they were kids. So yeah, why not have the tooth fairy do it? Give her quarters instead of getting them. The kids were just really, really more open-minded about this issue.
And came up with innovative solutions.
They did. And that's the kind of thing we need to look at. Why do they come up with these things? How do they come up with these things? And how can we be more like them? And as we watch them, we become more like them.
And Adora, I mean, back to Adora, it's when you see, if you go back to her YouTube complete talk, her TED talk, she talks about one of the projects. They went to a glass factory and they thought, well, giving the children a tour and saying, how can you do better? Or other products. And the kids were just didn't care all the logistics of how to blow glass, but they came up with all these different animals that could be done. And even, I guess a meat puppet or something they came up with. So,
a meat puppet.
Yeah.
I like that. I gotta watch that.
A bacon man.
I love it. But that's really cool. And she's adorable.
But the key point is that they didn't get all wound up with the logistics of blowing glass. They just went right to the solution of the different problems.
Well, and that's a great segue, Logan, and thanks for giving that example, Leanne, is the mission labs are really breaking frames. And the reason the mission labs are frame breakers is because bringing kids into the workforce is actually sort of jarring for people, right? It causes a reaction on behalf of the people who are in the workplace that, wow, what kids are doing here? I have no idea. And then for the kids to actually be in the workplace is really empowering to them. So it breaks the frame for the adults as well as the children. And what happens is the adults observing the kids in the workplace, more empowered, actually coming up with solutions that either is a specific company issue or issues that can be solved, homeless children are not able to get to school on time and just can't get to school with food, clothing, and just social stigmas. And then there might be other world or community issues that we would put forth to the kids. And the kids, yes, they might solve the problem with a very innovative solution, but the key is actually in the observance, going back to the steps that you all have already talked about. It's the opportunity for adults to observe kids in the work environment solve these problems so that ideally what has happened is to video this so that the adults, even after the kids have left the workplace, can go back and view these specific issues and this journey.
And talking and openness and sharing. It's all, these kids are just great at it. And right. We need to be reminded of it over and over.
And that actually, the benefits of this is that adults and companies need to solve problems today. We need to solve problems within our companies, and we need to connect with each other, and we need to also solve problems in our community. The catalyst for learning and understanding the potential of creativity can come through breaking these frames of bringing adults and children together, which is very family friendly, connecting the kids to each other. A lot of times the kids who are either one, the kids of the adults who work in the company or possibly outside kids that you bring in that are, for instance, millennials don't all have kids yet, but just bringing kids together in an enriched environment within the company so that they have an opportunity to not only be exposed to things they might not be exposed to in their own schools. But also we're connecting the kids to each other early because they are the workforce of tomorrow. And then it is an opportunity for the company bottom line to become more innovative. It helps them from a marketing standpoint and a branding standpoint. Do you want to mention anything else?
Carrie, I think you just did an awesome wrap on that. I mean, it's so much can be learned with this. And then the companies also can take it and use it as a promotion for how they're taking the new next step forward, and they can take the lead in doing these creative ideas and these innovative projects that haven't been done in so many companies yet. And maybe they'll be the next Google or the next Apple.
It also sets up the family environment, which companies always want that everybody to be included within the company thing. And so by bringing the kids in, it empowers the kids and for them to know what mom and dad do, you know, during day.
Absolutely. So to just wrap this up, everybody who is on this webinar will receive a Superhero Mission Lab Agent ID card.
Here we go.
Which that's actually part of the program, is the kids get these business cards, superhero cards also, because the premise of this whole thing is that a superhero does not fail. Or a superhero has powers that allow him or her to fail and still pick up and
move on, be successful.
Yeah. So you'll get your card in the mail. We will also be sending you, if you haven't already received it, the actual PDF of the presentation and links to the video. We hope that you'll also ask any questions after this by providing our call-in information, our telephone numbers, and our emails, and want to just get feedback in general if you enjoyed the webinar, because we enjoyed it and we enjoyed having you with us. And I think we're about to wrap up our time.
Yeah.
Do we want to open it up for any questions?
Or if anybody has a question to chat?
Let's see if that allows anybody to ask a question. Mary says, thank you. Thank you, Mary Kenner, for being part of this. I think then we're going to wrap this up because it's Friday, and go out and be superheroes, everybody, and
take
observe.
Those pictures.
Thank you, Jill. And thanks, everybody. Look forward to talking again to you soon.